Space Chicago. I'm really pleased to see all of you this evening. We are a community of space entrepreneurs, experts, and others interested in creating startup space companies in Chicago. So we appreciate your interest and look forward to an outpouring of space in Chicago. Before we get started, a couple of announcements. If you haven't found the bathrooms already, they're back the way you came, just the side of the big mural. Secondly, I want to give a shout out to our sponsors. First of all, MHUB is the space that we find ourselves in, and they're graciously allowing us to use the space. If you don't know what MHUB is, it's a manufacturing innovation center and startup incubator, and it's a great place to build a startup that's actually building things. Focused on manufacturing, but also the opportunity for creating startups that are focusing on space. Also, our beer tonight was sponsored by Metropolitan Brewing, a local craft brewery, also a startup. We appreciate their support. As some of you may be aware, we, New Space Chicago, was involved in the Edison Innovation Awards, which is a very prestigious award for innovative products and technologies. And we were instrumental in creating a new award category for space innovation. The awards gala was last night in New York City. I just flew back to Chicago today from the awards last night. And it was a very exciting event. There were two space startups that were awarded given awards for innovation. One was the company Made in Space, which you may be aware of. They are the company that has created the first 3D printing system that is on the International Space Station. So they developed a system for doing additive manufacturing in a microgravity environment. And they received the award for a new system called Arkanaut, which is a robotic 3D printer system that can create very large structures in space. That was very exciting. The second company that received an award was called CubeCap, and they are another launch provider. They are providing launch capability for small satellites by using an air launched rocket that will go to orbit. So very similar to what our presenter this evening is doing, except he doesn't use an aircraft. Anyway, so it was very exciting to have this new space innovation category at the Edison Awards. Also, I'd like to remind everyone that tonight is Yuri's night. We celebrate the first human to go into space. So after the presentation tonight, we'll have the opportunity to continue partying and celebrate space and our exploration of space. So without further ado, I would like to introduce Brian Stofiel of Stofiel Aerospace. Brian is an entrepreneur located in St. Louis. He went to St. Louis because of the history that the Midwest, and St. Louis in particular, has with the space program. The Mercury and Gemini teams were located in St. Louis, and he's been working with those engineers. They've basically come out of retirement to be involved in the development that he's been doing. So I'd like to introduce Brian.
Stofiel. I'm with Stofiel Aerospace. I started this company about 3 years ago as a company. The project's been about 5 years. We're developing a small satellite orbital launch system. So Boreas is a Rockoon. We put our rocket on a weather balloon. We send the weather balloon to 100,000 feet or so, and then we fire the rocket from there. So we're outside the atmosphere pretty much when we fire our rocket. 70% less fuel than a ground-based rocket, less engineering, less control problems, whole nine yards. So we don't have shock waves, we don't have max Q, or any of these terms, max dynamic pressure. Truly mobile system. The system fits in a shipping container. The shipping container gets shipped out, it unfolds and produces a launch platform. We can basically launch, we'd like to say, from almost anywhere in the world. I can take it out to the parking lot, because the actual launch happens at 100,000 feet. On demand, we can scale this system to the payload. So what happens right now is you scale the payload to the rocket, you have to fill up the whole rocket's lift capability before they'll actually fire the rocket at that cost. What we're doing is allowing you at $20,000 a kilogram to put a payload in orbit from 15 kilograms to 250 kilograms. And now you have a dedicated launch to your payload. So no longer are you waiting on somebody else's payload, no longer are you having to go to somebody else's orbit. You can go to your own orbit at that time. These are really scalable and storable for long periods of time. So we can fire, we can store it for up to 10 years. So what we got is Boreas. It's a three-point launch system. It's named after Greek gods. Boreas is the overall balloon launcher. Okay. Very simple, very effective. We can use helium or hydrogen to use as a lift gas. Helium allows us to fly where there's population. Hydrogen allows us to fly off the grid. We drop the system on the South Pacific Island and within about 3 or 4 days produce enough hydrogen to go into orbit. No infrastructure needed for us to launch. We have our own infrastructure, it carries its own infrastructure. We have Hyperion. Hyperion's our satellite return vehicle. So this is a small satellite return drone. We can fit three of these on our rocket. We can fire them into orbit with a 30-pound payload and then return your payload to Earth. We can do this a couple different ways. So for biological experiments, they want to get into their lab as quickly as possible. We can dive through the gravity well and keep your reentry in microgravity almost all the way to the ground and then level out at the very beginning. On the other side is the crystal growth. They want to come in soft into the atmosphere because they don't want to break those crystals, they just grew in orbit. So we can do a less than 1G reentry. To give you an example, SpaceX's Dragon reentry capsule is about 9Gs when you go over reentry. So you're talking about very different. The other thing is we can put imaging equipment in very, very low Earth orbit. So atmospheric skipping, you come in, you hit the atmosphere, you basically bounce off, and you're staying at very low atmospheres. We can allow Hyperion to do that. And now you're extending your mission life at very low altitudes. You've got imaging equipment, you're almost inside the atmosphere. You are inside the atmosphere, and you're still maintaining it. So the big thing is that you're not just a satellite we're going to push off there. With Hyperion, you've got onboard controls, we can give you power systems, we can give you environmentals if you need it. Boreas, the Hermes rocket, this is what we've been developing mostly for the last 3 years. We've put all our development, we've concentrated on one aspect that would give us the biggest advantage, and that's our solid rocket propellant. We have no liquid propellants inside the system. We thrust, throttle, and vector the solid rocket system. And we don't do this with outside inputs. So I'm not gimballing my nozzle. I'm changing interior structure to the nozzle to produce a different fuel. So we're modifying the balloon inside the nozzle system. Okay. 3D printed. We actually 3D printed out of PLA plastic on FDM machines. Okay. We pass that around. Okay. It's a hollow structure. We're at 3% infill. What we've developed is a positive molding, a positive structural molding process. And so our heat treatment gets sucked into the plastic and dopes the plastic. And then when it's firing, the endothermic ceramic replaces the plastic and becomes the structure. So it's a molding process that's being replaced with the plastic. They don't like me saying it's a plastic structure. But guess what? It's a plastic structure up to the moment of fire, up the moment. And then it's a ceramic structure. So what we got behind me, we fired 32 of these already. Static fire, we flight tested 4. We're preparing for summer flights. We're going to be launching from 90,000 feet, going to 750,000 feet, and 4,000 miles an hour. And what we're going to be firing with is this 3D printed hypersonic rocket. So the nose cone silver is where you have your payload. The gold band also signifies that this is an inert rocket. But the gold band is our separation charge. We get rid of any mechanical systems we can and replace them with chemical or electrical. And that basically cuts down on our failure rates, right? So instead of having a CubeSat with a spring-loaded mechanism, we fire another rocket and we do an explosive charge. Main electronics bay, we actually, all of our sensor antennas and everything are embroidered into the composite material. So they're part of a zero fail structure, much like the antennas on your on the NASCAR cars. They're actually embroidered into the composite weave. And then everything from here on back is the thrust system, and it's all 3D printed plastics. So you're looking at about an 8-pound, 9-pound rocket doing about 4,000 miles an hour. What this will do is it'll go up to 90,000 feet. We have Artemis that hangs, a drop drone that hangs off the bottom of the balloon. This will fire, the drone will go home, we'll recover the rocket this summer. We want to do 3 rockets in 3 days. We'll do that altitude. And that proves our reliability, it also proves our mobility, because we're going to fire from 3 different positions on this facility. So we've got a very big adaptable system, as you can tell. We've got our standard fairing, we've got a single payload. We're going to put a standard fairing on it, like we've got on this one. But what else we can do, like I said, is put the 3 Hyperion on there, and now you've got 90 pounds of payload that can be returned to Earth on a repeatable basis. And you can send those 3 different Hyperions to 3 different laboratories for independent verification. So they would all land about the same time, they'd all be in the same environment for a long period, and we have 3 labs and we can verify that. The Hyperion was developed because of our interaction with future customers. When we interviewed them, they said that repeatability and returnability is the one aspect of small satellites that is not being addressed. And it's one of the biggest to draw in the newest customers outside. So here's a Hyperion deploying satellites. One of the great things is we can deploy swarms of small satellites into very controlled orbits. So if you're familiar with what happened with the company Swarm, that the FAA denied their access because they couldn't track all the little satellite parts, that would not be a problem because you have a mothership with Hyperion deploying these actively. You're not just shoving out a bunch of them, you're actively deploying the swarm. And that should give a lot more safety margin. You can also deploy these swarms in much lower orbits so that if there is a collision, all that debris is out of orbit in 2 weeks. So you're not going to cause a Kessler effect where you basically, you've seen the movie Gravity, okay, where one satellite strikes another satellite, which strikes another satellite, and now you can't leave Earth orbit because you got garbage dumped around. If you put these in very low Earth orbit, they'll re-enter the atmosphere within days of each other. And that saves that worry about the space debris. So there's about 50 around the world that are under some kind of development in the small satellite launch market. We're one of 5 in this market that have any type of data. Most of the people you hear out there, you're gonna hear, or they've got concepts, and they're waiting for somebody to give them money. We're the exact opposite. We're actually proving our concept and developing our technology, and we've done it on a bootstrap basis. So my family in the last 3 years has put $500,000 of our own money into the company in order to get this thing running. That's how important my family sees space flight. And to give you an idea, my daughter is 5 years old when we started this. She's 12. She took 5th in the world this year as a new space leader of the year at 12 years old. Okay, she testified in front of NASA, she testified in front of the government. She pushed to Trump and Pence at the RNC. My offices were less than a mile away. She talked to both of them, including 18 senators and 13 congressmen. So we're not just a startup, like a concept. We're out there every day hitting politicians. We're out there every day, if you look at my social media, we're showing you what we're doing in the lab. Because we want to take you to space. My real market is 7 to 14 year olds, because they're the ones that are going to actually use my system and understand it. But we want to take everyone to space. We don't want to just separate, I want the scientist guy. No, we want that artist. We want that physical trainer, the one, any occupation is going to be needed in space, not just a bunch of scientists. Give you an idea, rocket scientists, okay? I like my motorcycles, I like my guns, we like to go on extreme adventures. Jim Patella, Vector, he's a race car driver. This NASA rocket engineer thing, this pocket protector, clean shaven guy, yeah, that doesn't exist. We're all a bunch of crazy guys. Rocketeers are weird. So compared to the other systems, we have a big difference. We're scalable, we're mobile, okay? We're on demand, we've got a return vehicle. We've listened to what the small satellite market has asked, and we've given them a product that they want. We haven't gone and engineered something and said, this is what we can do for you. We've said, what do you want from us? And then we produced that. And that's where we came up with a fully composite rocket. So there's a big difference when somebody says you're 3D printing. Okay, well, most of these companies that say I've got 3D printed parts, they're 3D printed in metal, right? We're not printing in metal. So think about the weight costs that they're incurring by printing in metal versus us who are printing plastics. If we did our engine in metal, it'd be a 70 pound motor, 80 pound motor, and we're talking about an 80 pound motor. So the weight savings are huge. So when people say 3D printing, you gotta understand that there's a difference in caliber of what you're actually doing with the 3D printing. The other one is that we are a static price, $20,000 a kilogram. Doesn't matter if you have a 15 kilogram payload or a 250 kilogram payload, it's $20,000 a kilogram. The other rockets, it depends on your payload, depends on other payloads as to what you're actually going to have. And by allowing the customer to say, I know my fixed costs, I know what research and development is going to cost, it's going to allow them to budget out. Something they haven't been able to do with previous systems because of the varying costs as it varied with the payload masses. Is there any questions? Let's get out of that. I can't go back. So we don't see reusability as a good thing in this payload class. You're talking about 800 pound payloads, you're talking about satellites that cost $30,000 to make, and you're charging them $4 or $5 million to launch. We want to get you down to the point where what you're paying to make the satellite is what your launch costs are. Now we're not there, but with mass production, I think we can get it down that low. In our first year, we want to do 1,000 missions to orbit. Okay, every other company out there is talking about doing 30 missions a year, or 20 missions a year. Think about 1,000 missions. Anytime you bring me a payload, I want to fire that payload. The unofficial slogan for the company is, you bring us your payload on a Monday, it's in orbit by Friday. And that's the turnaround time that we want, that we've been fighting for 2 years already. The FAA actually has been very good, because they've changed their rules in response to the commercial aerospace industry, specifically the commercial space industry. What used to be an 18-month review process is now 180 days. And that's because of other startups like us going in there and demanding that they readdress this issue. The swarm issue with the FCC just points out that you have to get multiple permissions from multiple agencies in order to launch a spacecraft. And this, as a startup, is unacceptable. I should be able to go to the FAA, commercial space, and say, I need my permits, and get all my permits in one spot. But that's not what happens. And that's been some of the problems with the startup. So where have we been? We're sitting right now at about heading into a seed round. We're looking to fund the 3 rockets for this summer. Each one of these rockets is going to cost me about $25,000 to $80,000, depending on the complexity of the rocket. And I just can't bootstrap it myself. but that's what we're going to continue to do. If we don't pull in that seed funding, we're going to fly one rocket. If we pull in the seed funding, we'll go 3. And we'll be one of 3 companies in the world that commercial small satellite companies
that have hit the carbon line. And that carbon line's 350,000 feet. It's a major milestone. Any questions? Anything I can answer? Yes.
So we've test fired 34 of these static fires. Okay, let me repeat. I'm sorry. He's asking about the propellant loads that we have and what we've test fired going up towards the flight models. We fired 34 of these rockets static fire, and we flight tested four. Our system can't be simulated right now, so we're creating data points to create a new math that is novel flight. We are solid rocket only, so we use our fluid dynamic principles. We can maintain pressures inside the vessels to maintain our throttle. So basically, we're still burning the rocket rod. Once you light it, it just burns, right? But we're maintaining the pressure inside the thrust system so that we don't lose that potential energy of burn. So if I need to throttle back, we just throttle back and maintain pressure inside the thrust, and then we can throttle. There are other examples of throttling, and I don't get too much into the throttling because it's some of our fluid dynamics, but if you look at the space shuttle, solid rocket boosters, the SRBs did throttle a little bit. And when they call that throttling, it basically is mitigation of thrust. They lose that potential energy, right? Once it's burned, it's burned. So you're mitigating the thrust. We don't do that. We actually are throttling and maintaining our potential. Now, it does deteriorate over a time frame. In a general setting, you can carry it. Solid rocket only, the good thing about them is they're stable. Okay? Liquid engines tend to blow up a lot. Liquid oxygen, you get a little bit of dust in it, you get a little bit of material in it, you shock it, you have it boiled off, that all is explosion. I can set this on the shelf for 10 years and nobody touches it, it doesn't do a damn thing. The liquid motors, as soon as you build them, they start to deteriorate. The tolerances start to go to hell and they start to rust. This, it can sit on the shelf. So we can pre-position it, like I said, for the FEMA and the on-demand market. We can position it in a position like California, when the earthquake happens, pull it off the shelf, an hour later you got a dedicated satellite to that emergency. That's an advantage that no liquid system will ever get. You cannot have, in order to get an ICBM, a liquid ICBM, it had to be fueled constantly in its cycle. And you're boiling off cryogens constantly. So you won't see an on-demand liquid engine until they can get around some of those cryogenic problems that they have. So solids are stable. We can ship it, standard shipping. The shipping industry knows how to handle incendiary devices. This is not classified as an explosive. It's an incendiary device. It just burns. So that's kind of the reason we've gone with the solids, is they're cheap. Every rocket, our rocket tests, we've been buying some of the propellant off the shelf from a high-powered rocket board. So I didn't need to go get liquid oxygen in my neighborhood and bring it to my neighborhood. Okay? Nobody's going to let me do that. Not in my backyard is the same, right? So that's why we're going with the solids. Everybody complains about the specific impulse of solids, which means I spend a little bit more mass to do the same amount of energy that a liquid engine does. I have to have a little bit bigger rocket in order to do the same amount of work that a liquid engine does. And we're gonna challenge that conventional wisdom. But we're not ready to release those numbers yet, but we're gonna challenge. We're going to get performance numbers that are better than conventional.
No, we won't have our IRSBs that are solid and liquid, but the conventional wisdom of a solid is what's going to change. And that's what we're changing with this thrust system. It's called tight flow. It's my PhD. So we're developing new novel way of using the fluid dynamics inside the engine to control the motor itself, to control the rocket itself. Less actuation and more actual effect when we do it this way. Good question.
Have you fired from a balloon yet?
We fired two from a balloon already. The Bella 1 and Bella 2 went off in 2015. The Bella 2 launched at 85,000 feet. The Bella 1 launched at 85. The Bella 2 failed to launch because of a stress relief problem. It was a bad design. It was my fault. I forgot to put a stress relief on one half of the harbor floor, and it deflated itself at that exact spot. So we're ready to fly our number 3. And this will be the first one where we've actually fired a Hermes rocket. So we'll have our thrust system on the system, and we'll be firing a straight shot in space with no guidance systems. We fired 4 ground-based rockets that will use the Hermes system. Anybody else? We do use guidance systems down the road, but the development. Where we think a lot of people make a mistake is they try to develop everything at once. And so you're spreading out all your best eggs out across a bunch of different pots. And what we've done is strictly gone with the biggest development first, which was the engine. And then we'll add on the guidance system next, and we'll add on that. And that prevents integration problems that you've seen from other launch companies that have failed. We don't want to mention any names, X-Corp. But those companies fail because they want to build everything at once and then bring it together and try to integrate. And what we'd like to do is actually integrate each step as we design it through the prototyping process. I can fire a nozzle, redesign it with the math, and have a new nozzle for you 45 hours later. So every 45 hours I can do a design change, a major geometry change if I want to. And that process is the difference. Why we got it this way. Yes?
With the conventional solid components, the IFP is, as you know, fairly old. Will that take at least 2 stages or 3 stages to orbit?
Well, we are multiple stages.
We are.
We don't drop our stages. Okay, so there are 8 motors that are being fired in here through a single nozzle system. Okay, and instead of dropping a stage, okay, we don't actually, the mass of the bolts of the control systems of everything was more than if I just left the rod in place. Because all that's left in a solid rod is the outer casing, right? That outer casing is almost nothing compared to those systems. That's the same reason we did a disposable system. The system burns up in orbit, we don't reuse anything of the rocket at all. Because at this payload class, it was cheaper than to produce a fly-on system. Yes.
So how do you manage a stabilization field once you launch it in your vacuum after some active? It's not guidance.
It's all passive. No active guidance.
But then how do you...
That's the tightest flow.
How do you manage stabilization though?
That's the flow where our flow, the internal of the flow to the engine is what does all the stabilization. And it's a passive system, so there's no input needed. In fact, there's only one moving part. But this is a classified aspect of the PhD, and if I set it right here, we can all go to jail. It's a ballistic missile. Never forget that if you're going to work in this industry. It's a ballistic missile. It's an ICBM. It can deliver a bigger punch than a nuclear warhead. If you come in from orbit at 17,500 miles an hour and hit the ground with tungsten rod, yeah, you're producing a bigger nuclear explosion. And you did it for the price of a small car. So don't ever think that the space industry, we are building weapons. We don't like building weapons, but they are because mankind misuses them. If I could give you a nuclear reactor the size of your cell phone, and it would power you for the rest of your life and be completely safe, is
as long as you didn't open it, I still couldn't give it to you because you guys would open it. The other one I always say is, I can put my pistol up here. It's a simple mechanical device run by a 2,000-year-old chemical reaction, and I've had police in all over this place. I put a ballistic missile up here that could wipe out a major city, and you'd all be up here touching it. So what is the real danger here? Well, the ballistic missile can wipe out a city. I mean, literally wipe out a city. So we don't, when we have, we get questions like that, we refer over, because if I open source this, I give everybody the opportunity to print this STL file. Imagine the chaos, right? So we don't talk about this stuff. We don't talk about what our e-coding is, right? Because then everybody can do the same. Any other questions?
I'm curious about the startup process, how you went from before the idea to the beginning of an aerospace company.
I developed a satellite with an MRI principle, a very obscure MRI principle. It's basically a spacing. And I finally came to the problem of the launch system. I can't get it into orbit. It was going to cost me 4 years of my life and about $2 million to put this 50-pound satellite into orbit just to test it. And that to me was unacceptable. So I went to my five-year-old daughter at the time and said, Bella, what do we do here? I don't want to spend 4 years waiting for a satellite to get into orbit. She goes, well, how long does it take to build a rocket? She goes, I guess we got to build a rocket then. About 5-10 years. So we started building it. She was 5, she's 12 now, and we built it the whole way. So it really, we came into the launch problem in the market before we even started looking at the problem. We understood it from a customer perspective before we decided to solve it as a problem. And once we decided to solve it as a problem, we discovered how big the problem really was. I mean, you're really, as a secondary payload, these small satellites that book themselves on 4 or 5 different rockets, wait 4 to 5 years or 6 or 7 years, and get bumped off of all the rockets. And if you're a graduate student, you want to see a project done in 2-3 years, you're never going to see that with the current launch systems. And that's what Boreas has designed with us. Like I said, on demand, scalability to a single payload, and 1,000 missions. If you've got the money, one of the complaints is, oh, the money's not there or the rocket's not ready. They're never there at both times. The money's never there at the same time as the rocket's ready. We don't have that problem. We've solved that problem. As soon as you're ready, as soon as you can pay me my money, I'll fire that rocket and go over for it. So now it's a matter of when does the funding come in, less of when is the rocket due. The Atlas rocket takes 6 to 8 months lead time to build. Ours takes 46 hours to build. There's a big difference there in just the lead time on building the rocket, let alone the fact that I can store my rocket for 10 years. And that Atlas, as soon as you build it, you need to get it off the pad quickly. Yes?
Can you talk a little bit about some of the unique challenges of the Raccoon test?
Yeah. The controllability of the balloon is a concern with the FAA. But we've solved some of that controllability issue. So a Raccoon, most rockets, they'll pre-program their launch configuration, their firing solution, because they know their starting point. As a Raccoon, we don't know our starting point. We know the general area, but we don't know our exact starting point. So what we've developed is the Zeus computer, and it does, basically it takes our GPS without using GPS, and then uses GPS as a backup and produces that firing solution on the call or on demand. So what the advantage is every rocket plane, every space plane, everybody that's going to be firing globally is going to want this Zeus computer. We do see it as one of our biggest products. It's a live global computer system. So no longer are you relying on the GPS systems. We've got ground-based tracking systems, we've got a ground-based radar system. So we can do all that without the need, I don't want to say it, but we don't, without the need for the US government and GPS. But that live over computer is a big product that we're kind of keeping trying. The next one, the Maneuverability, we have an Artemis wing drone underneath the balloon. And what that does is allow us to use it as a rudder to give us some guidance down the range. When we get one active here in about a month, we'd like to do a raccoon. And we're going to try and drop the balloon remnants into one of my employees' backyards here in Oklahoma. Because we want to show the FAA that we get it close enough. The other one is, balloons aren't sexy. This ain't a SpaceX landing on its butt, candlestick style, you know. This is a workhorse. We're the FedEx. We're your everyday ride to orbit to the point where you're going to notice three or four launches of ours and then never see us again. And we're just going to continue to operate in the background as the heavy launcher. I can't outlift SpaceX or Blue Origin or even Vector, but I can outfire them. And I can lift more mass than they can by outfiring them. So I can lift more weight in space by firing more rockets. And my rockets are cheap. Those kind of concerns you were worried about? There was two other raccoon companies out there, Zero to Infinity. They have a liquid engine. And they're kind of a little bit strange. They're running out of a fixed base, and they're a reusable system. The other one's on the concept board at UK Spaceport UK. They were the ones that tried to fire for the British government, but never got to that point. And they're on the concept board too. As raccoons, we're the leader in the world. With the data we've got compared to them is extraordinary. We have our own launch system. We have our own rocket. We're not borrowing or partnering with anyone else. We've developed it. And there's the biggest difference with a lot of these companies, with especially the ones that everybody compares us to, is we've developed it. We're doing it now. We don't have that waiting for funding type of thing. Firing rockets. Said, if I have to, I will pay for one rocket on my own. It's selling my motorcycle, selling my car, mortgaging my house again. I don't care. It's going. But we're not waiting for it. And I suggest anybody that's starting a business, don't wait for funding. Start it now. Do it without. Okay? Because you find other ways to do it. See another question? Did you guys have a question back there? Yes.
What does a catastrophic failure look like?
So we don't burn, we don't blow up. We've never had a detonation, or as Elon Musk says, RUD, rapid unscheduled disassembly. What happens is once the heat coating fails, it infiltrates the print and basically start venting outside the print. And then it just melts down. So we have melted down a couple times. It happens on, especially on the bigger rockets, if the heat coating fails. If we have a bad problem in the print, we can see it melt the rocket down. But we don't see explosions. What we do see in an abort is we'll crack the engine casings in half. So basically, you've got a big rod of engine, and if we have to go into abort, we'll basically start cracking it in half with explosives. And we can get about a 75% destruction rate on a abort system, which is a lot better than most of the spacecraft out there right now. We're sitting at a 30 to 40% destruction rate on an abort, which means you got debris raining down on you. Our debris is so light, it's so not metal, there's no density to it, that it tends to float. And so we don't have these high velocity particles that come slamming into the ground, like an abort with a regular rocket system. Yes? Yep. Yes. So the environmental impacts, AP per, ammonia perchlorate fuel, the solid fuel, is a very well-known fuel. And it mainly produces water vapor and CO2. Same with our heat coating. PLA plastic is cornstarch. It's literally biodegradable cornstarch. So in 5 years, it's supposed to totally biodegrade. The
I can't remember the chemical formula. The balloon itself is also biodegradable. So once it's in the high atmosphere, it's going to float down very slowly and just create the UV light. It doesn't even have to be in contact with the ground. So most of the system is biodegradable on its destruction. When we fall through the atmosphere, we're almost 100% destroyed. So when we come in and actually hit the atmosphere to re-enter, we destroy ourselves completely. And most of that is going to be coming off of CO2 and very, very low harmful gases. But the environmental impact is very small compared to an Atlas launch, compared to a SpaceX launch. This rocket is clean. Okay, 70% of the fuel that you use is getting from the ground to my launch altitude. So I'm using 70% less fuel than a ground-based launch or more. And then we get into the other composites too. So we're not green, but we're as close as you're ever going to get at this point. And we have to do environmental impacts across everything. Just the shockwave alone, from a sonic boom. We're allowed to break the sound barrier over the U.S. because we're a space system, right? Just the shockwave alone, we have to do an environmental study of the reflection of the shockwave off the top of the atmosphere coming back down to the Earth. So the environmental regulations in the industry are unreal. They're already so stringent that it's stifling to some of the businesses. Yes?
How long does it take for the launch to get to the
It's about an hour. Roughly, and then so the whole flight ends up to be about an hour and a half total. The flight time down is about 2 minutes. So we fall through the air column on purpose. Yeah, well, we want to get through that air column. A lot of the guys like to loiter, they like to have the parachute open a little high. We like to fall through the air column and then open really deep. That way we get out of airplanes. Loitering in at altitudes where the FAA is loitering us. So they're not exactly tracking us. We're not exactly able to control them. Midwest has always been where we started. And if you look at the last great migration of humanity, it was out of the Midwest. It was heading west with the Oregon Trail and all that. But really, it's the history of space flight here in the Midwest. St. Louis, you had Mercury. There was no NASA. There was no government space program. It was McDonald, James McDonald, Old Mac, and his team that built the Redstone rockets, Mercury, and Gemini. There was no NASA. In fact, NASA didn't build Apollo either. It was commercial companies contracted for NASA. So we think that's important. We came out of Cleveland, Ohio. NASA Glenn is there. And to be quite honest, they were squashing us. Every time an investor would come and want to invest, they go talk to somebody at NASA Glenn, and they'd call us a concept. Or they'd say something else disparaging. So we went to go to some place where commercial space flight was. And I don't like the West Coast. I grew up in California, I grew up in the East Bay of San Francisco, and I'll never move back to that city or that state. So Mojave's out, Seattle, I don't like Seattle, and St. Louis is in the middle of the country. So if I need to get my rockets on a train, I can do it. I can go to anywhere in the country on a train. Okay, I can send this rocket down the Mississippi, down to Cape Canaveral, down the Mississippi. I don't have to bring it across on a truck. So the transportation advantages were advantageous. We could get to different ports. We're a dual spaceport system already. We're going out of Spaceport America this summer, but we're signing contracts with Camden Spaceport in Georgia. So we want to be able to go anywhere in the world. And this was a fairly centralized location. And quite honestly, the natural disaster potential is low. Cost of living is low. The politics are fairly pretty low. So it's a better environment than we were seeing in some of the other cities. especially some of the cities that the space industry is already in. There's an advantage to not being where everybody else is. Yeah, you'd like to hang out with everybody, all the cool kids, right? Guess what? That's not what makes you cool. It's not hanging out with the cool kids, it's being the cool kid in the band. And we think St. Louis has been left behind because of that. Now, my family's from St. Louis, so I got a bias there. And with Boeing leaving, we think that the power of the vacuum is left there inside the employee market. So my employees, we're picking up employees that were exploited. Because they moved to Seattle, these employees didn't want to move. Or they weren't moving to Seattle. So these are the type of people we're getting. And the expertise. Cleveland was not qualified to handle the educational requirements that a PhD requires. So that classified nature of a PhD. There's only six colleges in the country that would actually accept this PhD. Because it'll never be published openly. It has to be published behind closed doors. And that's just not possible. Anybody else? Any questions? Alex, you want to say something?
I'm good.
This is my COO, Alex.
I'm a little disappointed when I signed on for this task a year ago. I was promised stuff was going to blow up. And I'm not going to lie to you. We just tested one of the biggest rockets we've tested just last month. And we buried half of it in the sand volleyball court. And I was sure I was going to get a show, and I didn't. I was really disappointed. So I mean, it's good for our development, but at the same time, it's not as sexy.
So one of the things we've done is we've hired U.S. military veterans. I'm Air Force. He's Army. My flight commander, my flight director is ex-Navy. And one of the biggest things is they don't ask me if it's possible. They asked me, how are we going to do it? And that is a big thing I can tell you right now. So if the person asks you, is that possible, get rid of them. Okay? Because they're just going to question every decision you make. But if they ask you, how are we going to do it, they're just ready to go. They're ready to implement. They're ready to start actually executing. And that execution, especially in the space industry, is what makes or breaks you. Okay. Doesn't matter what you say you can do, doesn't matter what you think you can do, if you can't execute, nobody cares what you can do. You've got to execute. And that's where a lot of startups are failing right now, is you're not executing. You've got to be able to execute, no matter if you've got the funding or you don't. No matter if you're going up against somebody who's a billionaire and you're sitting there having a day job, you've got to execute. At 35 years old, I went back to school. I left a $180,000 a year job, company car, company expense account. I left all that to make $6,000 the next year. And that $6,000 went into the company. Okay, so this is not about, oh, I've got the greatest thing. Believe me, we're not funded. My family pays for it, which means I don't take a paycheck. Nobody cares that you're going up against a billionaire and you're a day job. Just because you're in the space industry, you aren't different. You're still a startup. Do you have a question? Do you see your question? Okay. Yeah.
Why not pursue SBIR for this?
We did. And we got insulted. Clemson. NASA is not friendly to people that are coming in from outside the industry. So we literally got insulted by NASA and called, slapped together a challenge. So yes, you can go after the SBIR, but if your PI is not top level, you're gonna get ignored the first three times. So you know what it cost me to do that SBIR grant? It cost me $8,000, okay? That's 20 test firings. To be told I was slapped together challenge. Okay, so yeah, you can go after NASA and you can go after the government grants, but you've got to understand that your qualifications are going to be scrutinized to the point where unless you're running a PhD and you've got five PhDs on your staff with you, because I only had three. I had three PhDs from NASA,
from the University of Cleveland and from Case Western University, and they were calling us slapdtogether. Now, mind you, we fired the rocket the day after we submitted the proposal. We fired our first rocket. And by the time they had produced their review process, we'd already fired 7 rockets. And that's the difference, right? This was a brand new innovation, and getting it through a bureaucracy like NASA is almost next to impossible. And you'll hear this from everybody. If you're a true innovation, you look like you're crazy. You really do. If I had told you that I'm firing plastic rockets and you had never seen one, you'd think I was crazy. But we fired 34 of them already. So are we a concept? Is it crazy to say that I'm firing plastic rockets? But the SBIR, like I said, they had $11 million to give out SBIR that round. They gave out a total of 6 million. And it's to 4 companies that were big names that you all recognize. Not a single startup got a dime that round. And that's disheartening.
Why not DOD though? Or why NASA?
I don't make weapons. I don't build weapons. I will weaponize things. We don't build weapons. We may all be veterans, but I don't want that bomb falling on some girl's little head. Right? The space program is more important than making money. My family has said this before. I will weaponize it, but I'm going to space and I don't have time to make weapons. Making a weapon is a 5 to 10 year process, and that takes 5 to 10 years off of my space program.
And then there's the simultaneous concern with the golden handcuffs with DOD, DIUS, these groups coming in, preventing your access, because you have a unique technology that does all these crazy things, preventing your access to the body.
It's called a golden handcuffs. They give you a big bar of gold, but now you can't talk about anything you're doing. You can't do it publicly. They're golden handcuffs.
And we're extremely public about the development process.
Yeah, we don't hide it.
It's out there. We demystify it. In fact, the whole purpose of printing these rockets on, $500 printer, the original $150 printer, is to show people they can do this too. They can come up with innovation. They can have their own innovations. It doesn't require a ridiculous amount of money to do so. So
we have turned down go for weapons. They didn't want a launch system. They wanted a weapon. And we very early said we don't build weapons. It just is not. It's not profitable in the long run. And when we're talking long run, I'm talking generational. I got a 5-year-old, 12-year-old daughter now. When she's 40, okay, if we're still building weapons and we're in space, you guys are extinct. Like I said, this rocket can wipe out New York City. Imagine 10 to 20 years worth of development. We're talking about extinction level technologies now. I can't trust you with a simple mechanical device. How can I trust you with an extinction level device? And that's where it's going. So weapons, like we said, it's not worth my moral or the humanity's moral, because you get to the point that you can't use them ever again. You can't. You think nuclear weapons are bad, they ain't nothing compared to what you're about to see. Directed energy weapons are huge. And there's worse than that. Hypersonic, hypervelocity, reentry weapons. We used to call it the Thor's hammer. And it was basically a tungsten rod that was shot out at the Earth. And you're talking about taking a continent out. Not a country, a continent. And that's the type of things you're doing. So, you got a question? I'm sorry to come down on the weapons thing, but it's something the general public doesn't understand, that how destructive we're actually talking about. So let's get back to something nice. We're not going to Mars. We have some plans for Mars, but our actual long-term mission is Saturn. And it's because my daughter wants to be a biological engineer. Titan looks like a freeze-dried planet. Primordial freeze-dried Earth. And Enceladus is most likely got life. That's what Cassini probably told us.
Saturn system's pretty benign compared to Jupiter and compared to Mars. The radiation events on Jupiter and Mars are pretty high. You got no magnetic field on Mars. It means you're going to be living underground. You don't get a choice. You're underground. Okay, that's why Mr. Musk is building a boring machine. He's got his rover, his Tesla. He's got his boring machine to live underground, and he's got his rocket. He's going to Mars. He's building all the technologies together. So we don't see Mars as a great habitable place. The Saturn system, on the other hand, has got some great aspects to it. We're talking about Titan having 165 different hydrocarbons on the planet. There's only 300 types on Earth. You got liquid crude oil in an ocean on a planet, Saturn. The term fossil fuel is no longer a scientific term because of that discovery. So you're not burning dead dinosaurs, okay? You're burning some kind of byproduct from the planetary process. And that's what Titan showed us. You're talking about methane and crude oil oceans that are bigger than there are on Earth. Enceladus looks like Europa. Except Enceladus is heat, its heat output is higher than the tidals. So they're saying that the mathematics works better. And then you got a bunch of weird materials. Iapetus, got a belt around it, and it's got some very interesting rare earth elements or neodymium magnetic elements. Everybody's looking for water, but that's not for drinking, and it's really just for rocket propulsion. What we're really looking for asteroid mining is elements that don't exist on Earth. So when they talk about asteroid mining, don't think they're going out and getting gold and silver and platinum. Okay, silver's one of them because it's a consumable. What they're looking for is neodymium, helium-3, now, these elements that are so rare on the Earth or don't exist on the Earth. So helium-3 doesn't exist naturally on Earth. It's a byproduct of nuclear weapon development in the 60s. And this helium-3 is everywhere on Earth. And it's a great fusion reaction chemical. So you can fuse it and actually get a great fusion that's not nuclear. But we don't have it. And we're running out because we haven't produced it since the 60s. And it's used in things that you wouldn't think it's used in. So neutron detectors are used in hospitals and in radiation. They use helium-3. They use about 4 molecules of helium-3 in this detector. But the cost of that 4 molecules tripled in the last 3 years because we're running out of it. So that's the type of stuff that we're actually looking for mining, the stuff that doesn't exist here. So we always joke that, oh, I can grab an asteroid that has more platinum than the whole Earth. I can go grab an exotic material that has never been seen on this Earth. What does a unique exotic material? And that's the type of things that they're looking for in the asteroid mining. I think that's about it. If you guys have any questions, we have our website. Just got through the last page, it looks like. it's Stouffville Aerospace. Full social media out there. We try to make you feel like you're in the lab with us. So a lot of our development, you won't see a lot of detail there, but you get to see what we're doing. You get to see the test firing photos. You get to see some of the printing photos and that type of thing. We want to get you guys involved in every aspect of it. When we have a failure, we're not afraid to tell you, wow, that didn't work. Okay? Because guess what? It cost me $100 to do that test. Who cares? Do it again. Let's do it again. Let's do it again. And that's the thing. Fail fast. Fail often, but the big one is fail cheap. Fail inexpensive. Don't cost $40,000. Cost $100. That's $100. So, thank you guys for inviting us out. Appreciate it.
Thank you, Brian. I understand we have a test firing set up out of the parking lot. So we're going to have to set it up out of the parking lot, but I'd like everyone to experience the technology that Brian's been working on. So They'll move out into the parking lot, and then after that's done...
Give me about 10, 15 minutes.
So we'll move out in about 10 minutes, and then once the test demo is over, we'll come back and we can celebrate Uri's night. Thank you.